So let us start. In previous class, we discussed about the minimizing leakage current and the leakage power. We discussed that how the threshold voltage is an important parameter which is manipulated in order to minimize the leakage current and the leakage power on a given circuit. And we discuss how the transistors with different threshold voltages can be fabricated on the chip. And then apart from that, we also discuss about the different sources of the leakage power dissipation. So in this class, we'll be talking about the leakage current reduction techniques, the leakage current reduction technique. As we discussed in the previous class, there could be the techniques can be classified in two categories. The first one is the techniques that are used at the process level during the fabrication of the transistors and the circuits. Some initiatives are taken. So those initiatives, those techniques will be categorized under this category, the process level techniques. So under this category, we'll be talking about the channel engineering, the retrograde doping, and the Hallow doping. So these three techniques are basically used at the time of the circuit fabrication, device fabrication, and the circuit fabrication. Whereas there are other techniques which are circuit level techniques. So the circuit level techniques can further be classified as a standby technique. So when the circuit is in a standby mode, then the attempts are made to minimize the leakage current. So standby mode techniques will essentially include the VTCMOS technique. VT means variable threshold voltage, variable threshold voltage CMOS technique. Then the transistor stacking is one of the important technique which is used to minimize the leakage current in the standby mode. And multi-threshold CMOS approach is another technique. So multi-threshold CMOS approach is also used for standby leakage power reduction. Whereas the runtime techniques are those that are useful in both standby mode and when the circuit is operating. So under this category, we'll be talking about the dual threshold voltage technique. Dual threshold voltage technique. Then we'll discuss about the threshold voltage hopping. Then the dynamic threshold voltage scaling. So this is the classification of the different techniques that are used to minimize the leakage current reduction. So then we'll start talking about first the process level techniques. What are the process level techniques? So the first technique that we are going to talk about is the channel engineering. So you know that during device miniaturization, the device dimensions are scaled down as per the scaling rules. So if scaling rules are not followed, then may happen that the scale device will be subject to the severe short channel effects, and that will be responsible for the huge leakage current. So when the device is scaled down, then certain scaling rules are followed. And these scaling rules initially essentially includes the following. If we are going for a constant field scaling, then you can see the two version of a device. Let's say that the first one is the original device, So the original device has, you can see the source region, drain region, and gate is here, and the oxide thickness TOX. This is the oxide thickness, and the junction depth is XJ. This is the junction depth XJ, and around the source region and below the so-called channel region and the drain region, there will be depletion region like this. And the maximum depletion width in this case is turns out to be W, WD. WD is the depletion width in the channel region, you can see. So in a scaled device, the channel length is considered to be L here in the original device. So all the device dimensions, whether the lateral or vertical, these needs to be also scaled down by the same factor. So you can see that in a scaled device, the channel length is scaled down by the factor K. Oxide thickness is also scaled down by the factor K. The supply voltage VDD is scaled down by the factor K. And the junction depth XJ will also be scaled down by the factor A. So by the factor K. So when a device is scaled down, then these lateral and horizontal, lateral and vertical parameters are also scaled down, except the channel doping. The channel doping is increased by the same factor, and the increasing channel depth will ensure that the depletion width is reduced, because a thin depletion width is essential to have a minimum short channel effects in the device. So the doping is increased in order to reduce the depletion width. But while scaling down a device, we need to take care of a parameter which is called the aspect ratio, AR. I have already discussed about this, which is the dimensions in lateral direction divided by dimensions in the vertical direction. So a physical formula for this aspect ratio, which is derived from the basic fundamental equations like the Maxwell equation, it turns out to be L upon the oxide thickness TOX divided by epsilon SI upon epsilon OX to the power 1 by 3 into the width of the depletion region to the power 1 by 3 and the junction depth to the power 1 by 3. So you can see that in numerator we have a lateral dimension, which is channel length, and in numerator the channel length represent the lateral dimension here. L is representing lateral dimension, whereas in the denominator we have all the vertical dimensions parameters related to the vertical dimension. For example, the oxide thickness, then the width of the depletion region, and then the junction depth. So you need to know that this aspect ratio, a minimum aspect ratio, has to be ensured. A threshold value has to be ensured in order to ensure that the short channel effect is tolerable in a given device. So if we are reducing the lateral dimension of the device, the vertical dimensions have to be also reduced in a unison manner, so that this aspect ratio doesn't go below a threshold value. So we need to ensure that we need to ensure that this aspect ratio should be in fact large, so that if the vertical dimensions are smaller compared to the lateral dimension, then the aspect ratio will be large, and the sub-threshold, the short channel immunity will be more in the channel. So what is done, we have to reduce the vertical dimensions like oxide thickness, the width of the depletion region and the XJ, all are reduced in order to a large value of this ER. So this arrow is shown here, it's wrongly saying a smaller value is needed, but it should be a large value of AR. A large value of AR can be ensured by the smaller, the thinner oxide thickness, less wide, thinner depletion width, and the thinner junction depth. So, apart from this adoption of the proper scaling rule, in order to scaling rule for minimizing the short channel effects and the leakage current as a result, there are some there are two other techniques which are used for the leakage current reduction, and those techniques are categorized under the well engineering. So in under well engineering, the channel doping is modified, and it is modified in such a way that the leakage current is minimized, and at the same time the on current and the saturation current and the linear current of the transistor is increased. So the well engineering essentially is it could be either a super steep retrograde doping, or it could be a halo implant. So both of the techniques, the halo implant and the super steep retrograde doping, these techniques are used to minimize the leakage current, and sometime these techniques are used to ensure the leakage current to a particular level, and at the same time the on current, which is saturation current and linear currents, that are increased. So let us talk about this retrograde doping first. So just look at this picture. This is a structure of a conventional MOSFET, and here is the source region. This is the source region, and this region is the source extension region. So the source is basically heavily doped N plus region, and the source extension region will have a little bit lower doping than the source, the main source region. Similarly, the drain has a very high doping level here, N plus, and the drain extension is a little bit lightly doped, and this lightly doped drain extended region will ensure that the electric field is low near the drain channel interface, and that is useful for minimizing a number of undesirable effects. So the source drain extension, so next to the source drain extension, you can see that a P layer in this region, a P type doping is carried out, which is the doping is slightly greater than what the rest of the substrate has. So if the substrate has let's say that a particular doping level of 10 to the power 16, so this region will have a doping greater than that. Similarly, a similar structure is also created next to the source extension, as the drain extension region, as the region here was next to the drain extension region. So this is this called the halo doping. We'll come to this little bit after some time. Apart from this halo doping, you can see that there is another highly doped region which is below this substrate. You see that the substrate, this region has a moderate doping, whereas below this substrate there is a region which has a high doping level, this region P plus. which is called the retrograde doping. And you can see, you can check, see the profile here. So here this region is basically the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. This region is silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Silicon-silicon dioxide region. This line is representing the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. And below this, this is the channel substrate region, which has the normal doping level. And then this region, in this region, which is P plus here. So this P plus region is having a very high doping. So if the doping profile is like this, we call that channel has retrograde doping. And there could be other possibility when the entire channel region is uniformly doped. So that is represented by this dotted line, where the entire channel region is uniformly doped. In retrograde doping, the channel next to the substrate next to the silicon-silicon dioxide interface is lightly doped, where the region which is a little bit away from this silicon-silicon dioxide interface has been doped highly. The doping here is quite large. So retrograde is a non-uniform doping, and basically it's a kind of low high doping, you can say, where the region next to the substrate is low doped, and the region far away from the substrate is highly doped. So this is the retrograde doping profile. And what is the advantage of this retrograde doping profile is this. You can see that if you see the band diagram, energy band diagram in the vertical direction, so this is representing silicon-silicon dioxide interface. This is your oxide region, and this is the bands. Let's say that this is the edge of the conduction band. This is how the bands are bending. So the first one, the dotted line one, is representing the uniform doping. So if there is a uniform doping, then let's say that in both cases, the depletion thickness is this much, XS equal to WDM. So when the doping is uniform, then you can say how the bands are bending here. And if the in case of retro grade doping, the band is bending like this. So you can see that here, when the doping is uniform and light throughout the substrate, then bands this conduction band bends all of a sudden in this length only. So this is representing a high electric field in the channel region, which is next to the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Whereas in this case, since band is bending slowly, so the electric field is not as high as the interface. So the higher electric field in the first case, where the doping is uniform, then because of the high, because of the moderate electric field, there is a less scattering of the carrier. So the electronic mobility, surface electronic mobility, is found to be higher than the second case. In the second case, where there is a retrograde doping, so because the electric field is low, and also the channel doping is low near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, then because of the low doping, the scattering will be less, and field-induced mobility degradation will also be less. So surface mobility is found to be higher in case of retrograde doping, and it is relatively less for the uniform doping profile. So this increased electronic mobility will ensure that the on current will be higher for the given leakage current. So this is how you can see that the retrograde doping helps. There is another advantage of having this retrograde doping, because the region which is highly doped, which will prevent the possibility of, which will restrict the possibility of punch through. You know that in a punch through means when the two side depletion region can meet at some point, even if the gate voltage is not applied. So if the two depletion regions meet at some point, then there may be a path may be created for the current flow. So that is actually avoided. That is avoided by this retrograde doped level. So this is also good from that respect, from the prevention of the punch through viewpoint. So retrograde doping is introduced in sub 0.25 micrometer technology node, and it was widely used for improving the transistor characteristics. Then the next technique, which is okay, there are a few more things I have to say about this retrograde doping. Is the good thing about the retrograde doping is it will actually decouple the threshold voltage with the depletion region. You see that in a uniformly doped MOS transistor, the depletion width can be given by this formula. Depletion width is 4 epsilon Si 5V upon QNA. So the depletion width is inversely proportional to 1 upon square root of NA. And in a scale device, what we do, we have to minimize, we have to reduce this WDM. So depletion width has to be reduced, and in order to reduce the depletion width, we have to increase the channel doping. So if we increase the channel doping to reduce the depletion width, what will be the consequence? The consequence will be that the threshold voltage will be increasing, because the threshold voltage is proportional to square root of Na. So the threshold voltage will increase, and if the threshold voltage is increased and the supply voltage remains constant, then this is also an issue, because the circuit will become very, very slow. So what is required is a mechanism is required, and a mechanism should be capable of decoupling this depletion width from the threshold voltage. If it happens, then the depletion width could be minimized in order to ensure the minimum short channel effect, and at the same time the threshold voltage will also not increase. So in this regard, this retrograde doping also helps. The retrograde doping basically decouple this the depletion width with the threshold voltage of the device, and it gives a more flexibility from the design viewpoint. But although, however, if this retrograde doping decouples the threshold voltage with the depletion width, but the subthreshold slope factor M, which is equal to 1 plus epsilon Si upon WDM into epsilon OX upon TOX. So this, however, is a function of the depletion width. You can see if the depletion width decreases, then the subthreshold slope factor increases, and you can basically, this is subthreshold swing factor. This factor increases, and the subthreshold swing is basically given by natural log of 10 into MKT by Q. So if we reduce this depletion width, although it is not going to affect the threshold voltage in a case of for a device which has retrograde doping, but it will affect the subthreshold swing. The subthreshold swing will increase. So because the subthreshold swing is proportional to M, and M is, you can see that, inversely proportional to this WDM. So while designing the device, this need to be considered. And here you can see that there is a limit for this M. So this M is considered to be less than 3/2 in order to ensure the minimum in order to ensure that the subthreshold swing doesn't increase at very high value. You see that basically this is not slope, this is subthreshold swing. So this subthreshold swing should be is a function of m. So if m increases, then slope will increase. So there is a limit for this m. This m should not increase to greater than 1.5. Otherwise, there will be a significant increment in the subthreshold swing, which will be very, very bad. So a limit is given while designing a device about the subthreshold slope factor m. The subthreshold slope factor is considered to be less than 1.5. It needs to be ensured. It is ensured that this is less than this 3/2. So considering all these factors, there is a design guidelines here presented for the TOX and the VDD, and you can see that the TOX and should be the oxide thickness and WDM should be selected in such a way that it will be good to operate the transistor without compromising much with the performance. For example, you can see here that at y-axis you have TOX. So the TOX, there is a minimum value for the TOX that is representing this, because the TOX is basically VDD upon Emax. So if we consider a very thin gate oxide, then that is going to increase the electric field in the channel region. And there is a maximum limit for the electric field that is actually should be respected, because if the electric field in the channel goes above that critical value, then that could give rise to a lot of undesirable effect. There could be significant reduction in the mobility, and there could be some other undesirable effect. So there should be a minimum value of the oxide thickness that is respected for a given transistor, because if the thickness is taken below that, then there will be region of very high electric field, which should be avoided while designing the device. Then there is another boundary here. You can see that the TOX, the M value should be less than 1.5. So M value should be less than 1.5. M value is this 1 plus epsilon Si WDM upon epsilon OX upon TOX. You know that based on this epsilon S and epsilon OX value, if these values, so basically here there is a mistake, it's maybe TOX by epsilon OX. So considering this condition that M is less than 1.5, we get this relation that 3 times TOX by WDM should be 1/2, and 1/2 because 3/2 minus 1, so we get 1/2, and the epsilon SI divided by epsilon OX, because of that differences in the relative permittivity of the silicon dioxide and silicon, we get this factor 3. So this need to be respected. This 3TOX upon WDM should be less than 1/2. So there is a boundary here. You can see this line is representing that the threshold where 3TOX by WDM is half. Okay. So if this 3TOX by WDM goes above greater than 2, we enters into this region, which is a region of poor subthreshold slope. So this should also be avoided while designing a device. And then there is another region, because when we reduce the depletion width, or the depletion width in order to the depletion width can be controlled by the channel doping, But at the same time, we need to also consider that the depletion width plus 3 times the oxide thickness. This should not go above L by 2, half of the channel length. Means this is basically the vertical dimension. You can see the depletion width is the vertical dimension of the device, and oxide thickness is also related with the vertical dimension of the device. So sum of the depletion width plus 3 times the oxide thickness, this should also not go above L by 2. So if this goes above L by 2, then transistors enters into the region of poor short channel effects, and this could also be a region for the larger leakage current. So the design space is given here for W and the oxide thickness, W and the VDD. And the parameter should be selected in such a way that the transistor should be operating in this region. You can say this is the safe region in which the transistor should operate, because in this region the substrate slope will be very high. If the parameter will not be chosen properly and the device dimensions, if we parameters are chosen in such a way that the device will be subject to the short channel effects in this region, and in this region there could be high electric field that may also be responsible for the degradation of the performance in the device. So the oxide thickness TUX, VDD and WDM will be chosen in such a way that the transistor will be in this region, and the device will be perform better in terms of lesser subthreshold slope and lesser subthreshold swing, and the better short channel effects immunity, and at the same time lesser electric field induced degradation effect. So this is a design guidelines given for the device for the different parameters. If these relations are respected, then device will perform better and the leakage current will be smaller in the device, and therefore when the circuit will be designed, then the leakage power dissipation will also be small. Then the halo doping. The halo doping, as I said, that was is the third technique that can be used to minimize the leakage current. So as I said earlier, that in halo doping, a guard ring is created next to the source extension region and the drain extension region. So this is a P plus region, and this P plus region will ensure that the depletion region, because the source is supposed to be highly doped region, and the channel is a little bit lightly doped compared to source. So most of the depletion width will encroach in the source region. So this will ensure, so the depletion width will actually increase, but fabricating or by introducing a halo doped region next to the source and the drain, the depletion thickness next to the drain region can be minimized. So WDM can be reduced, and with the reduced WDM, the charge sharing will be less, and because of the less charge sharing, the threshold voltage roll off will be less. So here you can see that the threshold voltage variation against the channel length, you can say, and if the only retrograde doping is being considered, then you can see that the threshold voltage decreases rapidly with the channel length, whereas in the case of super halo, if the halo doping is created next to the source and drain region, then the threshold voltage short channel effects will be less, and this curves gets the nature of this curve is such that it is not showing the trend of there is no fast change in rapid change in the threshold voltage when the device channel length is decreased. The variation is almost flat, you can say. if the threshold voltage is not reduced much at the lower channel and dimension, then the possibility of the subthreshold leakage current will be less, and the leakage power will also be less as a result. So we discuss about the three techniques for reducing the leakage current, and these techniques are basically the channel engineering, the retrograde doping, and the halo doping. These are process level techniques. These can be employed at the time of the device fabrication only. So this is one time scheme, you can say, and while the device is in foundry, this is done. These techniques will be used when the device is in foundry for the fabrication purpose. However, there are some other techniques which are circuit level techniques, and you will see that how these techniques could be useful for minimizing the leakage current. The circuit level techniques are basically based on the threshold voltages, threshold voltage of the transistor. So there are two techniques. These circuit level techniques can be classified as a standby techniques and runtime techniques. So standby technique is used when a particular block of the circuit, particular section of the circuit is, let's say, clock gated. So no switching activity is happening. So the sole aim is to reduce the leakage power. So under this category, we'll be talk about the transistor stacking and the variable threshold voltage CMOS and multi-threshold voltage CMOS. Runtime technique are dual threshold, VTH hopping, and dynamic technique. We'll be discuss about these techniques once we have finished our discussion on the standby mode techniques. So let us go to the standby mode techniques. We'll start discussing with the transistor stacking. Circuit level technique for leakage power reduction. Let us start with the transistor stacking first. Okay. So to understand the transistor stacking, we can consider the case of a two input NAND gate. So in two input NAND gates, you can say the two P transistors and the two N transistors. These are M1 and M2. So the two inputs are A and B, and the output will be taken from here, which is maximum output is when output is high. This is VDD. When output is low, this is supposed to be zero. So let's say that for a given in a given situation, that the two inputs A and B, the input vector is 0 0. Let's say that A is 0 and B is also 0. So if the input vector is 0 0, then the two transistors M1 and M2 are supposed to be in off condition. So if the two transistor in off condition, even in that case, some subthreshold current will be flowing, some leakage current will pass through the two transistors, and therefore there will be a current here. Okay, and because of this current, you will see that this node will have a potential. Let's say at the same time, since the two inputs are 0 0, the output is high here, which is VDD. So if the output is high VDD here, then the potential of this node is Vm, which is a positive value, which is between 0 and VDD. It must be a positive voltage here. So now see what is the consequence if this potential becomes positive. So if this potential becomes positive, then if we consider the transistor M1, if we consider this transistor, then now the gate to source voltage, since the input A is 0 here and this is Vm, which is positive, so the gate to source voltage of this transistor is now become negative. And a negative gate to source voltage means the subthreshold current is exponentially related with VGS minus VTH. So negative gate to source voltage means smaller subthreshold current. So this is one of the good thing, because of this positive, because of the potential, positive potential of this intermediate node, the gate to source voltage of the transistor M1 is has become negative, and this negative gate to source voltage will ensure that the sub threshold current that is being conducted through this transistor is very very small. And you should also consider, since the two transistors are connected in series, this is this transistor and the two transistors are connected in series, so the smaller current will be the smaller current that is allowed by the two transistor will be the series current. For example, let's say that for this transistor the gate to source voltage is zero. So for gate to source, so this transistor theoretically can conduct a larger sub threshold current than the transistor M1, but since the two transistors are connected in series, then the overall sub threshold leakage current is going to be small because of the smaller sub threshold current that can conduct through the transistor M1. So this is one of the good things that will happen because of this positive Vm, and this you can see is going to reduce the sub threshold current of this given sub threshold current of the transistor, and therefore the overall leakage current of this circuit will also reduce. And this is not true for only 0-0 input combination. If let's say that the two inputs are 0-1, so in that case one transistor will be conducting, other will be off. But even in this case, the leakage current will be determined by the current will be determined by that transistor which is going to conduct the smaller current. So this is one good thing. The another good thing is since Vm is positive, and let's say that the body of this transistor M1 is not connected to the source, but the body of the transistor M1 is connected to some independent voltage, some independent voltage is used to bias the body of this transistor. So since the source potential is increased, so since the source potential is increased, then VBS body to source becomes negative because the source is now increased. Let's say that the body is connected to ground. Let's say that the body of this transistor is connected to ground, so at zero level, and in that case if the source voltage become positive, then the substrate body potential becomes negative. And you know that when the substrate body potential of a transistor is increased, it is when it is made negative, then the threshold voltage of the transistor increases. So the increased threshold voltage in that case will also be a reason for the smaller subthreshold leakage current, because IDS is proportional to VGS minus VTH. So large and positive value of VTH will ensure that smaller subthreshold current will flow through this circuit. So this is one of another advantage that of this positive potential at the intermediate node. Okay. Then there is another advantage that is pretty obvious, that the drain to source voltage of the transistor M1 is now smaller, because let's say that if this node is at the ground potential zero level, if the potential of this intermediate node is zero, then the drain to source potential for transistor M1 would be VDD. But in this case now, since the because of this potential Vm, now the drain to source potential for the transistor M1 is VDD minus Vm, which is less than VDD. So the drain to source potential has been reduced significantly, and you know that the drain to source potential has a direct relation with the drain induced barrier lowering effect. So the drain induced barrier lowering effect is now less prominent. Because of the drain induced barrier lowering effect, the threshold voltage decreases and the leakage current will increase. But in this case, since VDS is small, so the DIVL effect will not be very severe, and as a result the threshold voltage doesn't decrease, and as a result you will see that the leakage current that will conduct through this transistor will be even smaller. No impact of drain induced barrier, no significant impact of drain induced barrier lowering is expected. So you can see that the stacking of the transistors, if the transistors are stacked in this particular fashion, then it is good for the leakage current reduction. And however, there is a one important challenge in this kind of transistor stacking, since it is a standby mode technique. So when this, let's say, particular circuit is goes in the standby mode, then we need to find out which input vector is responsible for the lowest leakage current. So that input vector should be identified, and when the circuit goes into the standby mode, accordingly that input vector should be fed in order to the minimum, to ensure the minimum leakage current. So if the circuit is very simple like this, then all possible input combination can be tried out, and the input vector can be determined, which will be responsible for the lower leakage current. For example, if there are two inputs here, so there will be 2 to the power 2, 4 possible input combination: 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1. So all four inputs can be applied here, and the circuit can be very easily analyzed, and we can very easily figure out that what is the input vector which is responsible for the lowest leakage current. So when this circuit is sent to standby mode, then that input vector will be applied here, and which is responsible for the lowest leakage current. But let us say that the circuit of interest are a bigger portion of a given circuit is goes into will be subject to the clock gating. So that a bigger hardware portion, a bigger portion of the processor, let's say, is going to the standby mode, then it will be very, very difficult to find out what will be the input combinations, what will be the input vector that will be responsible for the lowest leakage current. For example, let's say that we are dealing with a circuit which is going to receive a 32-bit input. So 32-bit input means the 2 to the power 32-bit combination. So this is a huge combination, and we cannot try each combination for a given circuit in order to find out the input vector which will be the best one to cut down the leakage current. So in that case, the different approach is adopted, and in that case the random search based techniques can be utilized in order to find out the input vector which is suitable for the lowest leakage current. Our genetic algorithm can also be utilized in order to determine the input vector which will be suitable for the leakage current minimization. So this is about the stacking, transistor stacking. So transistor stacking is useful for leakage power reduction, but mainly in the standby mode. This technique is not very effective in the case, in the runtime case. Okay, so now let us discuss about the second technique, which is also very important, called the multi-threshold voltage CMOS approach, MT CMOS approach. So as the name suggests, that in this approach, the transistors with the different threshold voltage will be utilized. So just look at this circuit. In this circuit, you can see the two different type of the transistors. One is, of course, classification is based on N-type and P-type. So there are some N transistors and there are some P transistors, as you can see. So you can see that in this circuit, there are N transistors and P transistors, and at the same time, there are the transistors with high threshold voltage. So the transistors with the high threshold voltage, be it a N transistor or P transistor, is shown like this. this line is a thinner one, and the transistors which has a high threshold voltage is shown by this symbol. So this transistor, these are transistors with high threshold voltage value. This is a transistor with low threshold voltage value, but this is a transistor with high threshold voltage value, but wrongly it is represented by this hashed red in section. So in this case, you can see if you forget about the header, this P transistor, and the footer, this N transistor. If you forget about header and footer, then what you see that this is nothing but a NAND gate. So a NAND gate is implemented with a low threshold voltage transistor. Okay, so if let's say that the power supply is given here VDD, and this is grounded, then this is going to act as a NAND gate, and the NAND gate will perform better. The speed will be higher, there will be less delay because the transistor threshold voltage is low. You know that when you increase the threshold voltage of the transistor, the delay increases. So the NAND gate is designed here with the transistors with low threshold voltage value. But if the transistors are having designed with the low threshold voltage value, then the problem will be they will leak larger current. The leakage current will be large in this case. So how to minimize the leakage current when the transistor, when the circuit is in standby mode? With the help of these two transistors, the header and the footer. The header one is a sleep control transistor, which is a P-type with a large threshold voltage value, and the footer, which is a again N-type transistor, which is a sleep control transistor, and this is also a transistor with large threshold voltage. And the sleep input is given to the P transistor here, and sleep bar input is given to the N transistor. So this is one implementation, and you can see that if the transistor is in active mode, so when the sleep signal is zero, when the sleep signal is zero, then the transistor goes into the active mode. So if sleep signal is zero, then this P transistor goes on. The N transistor will also go on because it will be on because the sleep bar is one. So a high gate to source voltage, this transistor is on, and if this transistor is on, then this the source is at the ground level. So the drain of this N transistor will also be close to zero. So this is a kind of virtual ground. So that's why we see that it is represented as VSSV. And as far as the header is concerned, since the sleep is zero, the header is also on, and therefore this virtual line, power line, will be charged to VDDV, which is VDD, the power supply, and because of this P transistor is on, the potential of this virtual power line is also will also be close to VDD. So in this case, this NAND gate will be working with the virtual supply voltage VDDV and the virtual ground VSSV, and also at the same time the threshold voltages of the transistors that are involved in the logic action is low, so the circuit will perform faster. The operation, the circuit will give rise to lower delay. So the circuit will be very very fast in this case. So it will perform performance will be much much better. But at the same time, let's say that if this circuit is need to go to the standby mode. So if the circuit needs to go to the standby mode, then the sleep will be one, and if the sleep signal goes one, then sleep bar goes zero. So zero sleep bar means the P N transistor is off. And at the same time, the P transistor will also off. And the two transistor, P transistor and N transistors, are high threshold transistor. So they will leak lesser sub-threshold current because their threshold voltage value is high. So the two transistors, the header and footer, are going to conduct very, very small sub-threshold current. And that is the current which will also pass through the transistors that are used in the implementation of the logic function, but since the transistors are stacked one over other, so it is the transistors with the high threshold voltage value, they will determine the leakage current, and therefore in the sleep mode, in the standby mode, the sub threshold current of this the leakage current of this circuit will be very very less. So when the active when the signal has to be processed, then the transistors with lower threshold voltage will operate, and the circuit will be faster. When this has to go to the standby mode, then the top and bottom transistor, the header and footer, goes in off condition. They will conduct less sub threshold current. So therefore, the transistors which are to be used for logic function, these transistors with the lower threshold voltage value, they will be also forced to leak smaller leakage current. So overall leakage current will be very very small in this case. And you can also see that this was you should also know that the original empty CMOS, which was proposed by probably an Indian group, is like this, where both header and the footer transistors were used. But the same the performance can be further can be also improved by using, because the two header and footer will require lot of silicon area. So there could be another alternative where either header or footer is to be used. So in the second arrangement, you can say that only PMOS transistor is inserted, only header is inserted, because it is the PMOS transistor which will determine what the leakage current will flow in the active logic block during the standby mode. And similarly, in the third arrangement, you can see that the supply voltage is VDD, but the leakage current is being controlled by this N transistor. So this is NMOS insertion, this is PMOS insertion. So either NMOS or PMOS can be inserted in order to minimize the leakage current. And in this case, the good thing will be the area will also be reduced, because in these two implementation, only one transistor is needed. And at the same time, if you have also the flexibility that either we can choose either of the implementation, then this we will be choosing this one, because this will include N transistor compared to the P transistor, because for N transistor the area requirement will be even smaller than the P transistor. So this will be the better design. So you can see that the multi-threshold voltage MTCMOS technique is also useful for minimizing the leakage current and the leakage power. Okay, so let us stop here today. We'll continue this next class. If you have any question, doubt, then you can ask anybody. Any question? Please feel free to ask. Sanjeev, do you want to ask a question?
No, sir.
No. Anybody?
Sir, in the sir retro doping portion, sir, what is the retro doping part, sir? Is it the non-highlighted portion?
Retro gate part is this. Can you see the PDF file?
Yes, sir.
So this is the P plus region. Okay, the hashed region.
And sir, upper portion of the
hashed region, P plus region, which is a little bit away from the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. So this is silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Below this, there will be normal doping. And far away from this interface, we have this P plus hashed region. So this kind of doping profile, where the doping is low near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and all of a sudden it goes to a high value. So it's a kind of low to high non-uniform doping. This is the retrograde doping.
Okay.
So retrograde doping will modify the electric field profile in the channel region, which is useful for increasing useful in increasing the mobility of the carriers and the on current, and at the same time the punch through current can be minimized. So the leakage current can also be reduced.
And sir, you said that rho x equal to vdt divided by e max. If sir high electric field is there, sir, what will be the problem?
Okay. Means your question is this. For this reason, why we have to ensure that the field doesn't go above a certain limit. So that is very obvious. If the field is very high, then there could be oxide breakdown, there could be silicon breakdown, anything can happen. Okay, so that's why there must be a limit. For example, there if you get increase the gate voltage to a high value, and at the same time oxide is very thin, so very large electric field will set up in the oxide that may go above the breakdown voltage of the oxide. So the oxide will be breakdown, and it may perform, it may start working like a conductor. Anything can happen. So to ensure a reliable operation, so the limit of a maximum electric field need to be respected.
Okay.
Any other question, anybody? Okay. So